Today, we are on a bit of a mission, really. We're cutting straight to the core of one of the most, you know, debated topics in economics, the link between the amount of money in the system and the prices you see every day. We want to give you a quick, powerful shortcut to understanding this key concept.
Right, because we've all heard the terms, you know, money supply and inflation thrown around all the time.
Constantly.
But you rarely get the actual foundational mechanism that connects them. So today we are diving into something called the quantity theory of money, or QTM.
Okay.
And you should think of it as, I guess, the classical economist's main tool for predicting inflation.
So, okay, let's unpack this, because we're starting with something that, well, it isn't really a theory to begin with. It's more of an accounting identity.
Exactly. It's an ironclad truth. It's just a way of framing all economic activity.
How does it work?
It simply states that the total amount of money spent in an economy, it must equal the total value of all the goods and services bought in that same period.
Okay, I want to break this down piece by piece. Let's focus on the concepts first. So on one side of this identity, you have total spending.
Right.
And that's made up of two things working together.
Yep. The first factor is the money supply. That's M.
Right.
It's just the total amount of dollars or pounds or whatever that's, you know, circulating in the system.
So all the cash, bank deposits, all that stuff.
Pretty much. And the second factor is where, like you said, the real magic happens. The velocity of money.
Velocity. So it's not just how much money there is, but the speed of that money.
Exactly. It's how many times that average dollar changes hands in, say, a year. Think of it like a hot potato.
Okay.
If I use a $10 bill to buy a coffee, and the shop owner immediately uses that same bill to pay, I don't know, an electricity bill.
Right.
And then the utility company used it to buy new equipment, that one $10 bill just facilitated $30 of transactions.
And it did it really quickly. So that's the high velocity.
That's high velocity. Right. But if you take that $10 and just stuff it under your mattress for a year,
its velocity is basically zero.
Exactly. So if we multiply the total amount of money, M, by the speed it's spent, V, that gives us total spending, that's one side of our equation.
Got it. M times V, total spending. So what's on the other side?
Well, the other side is the total value of all the transactions. You know, what that spending actually bought.
Okay.
And that is also made up of two factors. First, you have the price level, P. This is just the average price of everything in the economy.
And the second factor?
That's real output, the Y. This is the volume of actual goods and services produced, the real stuff.
So not the dollar value, but the number of cars, the number of haircuts, the amount of software written.
Precisely. It's what we often measure as real GDP. So you multiply the average price level, P, by the total quantity of real output, Y.
And you get the total dollar value of everything that was sold.
And because every dollar spent has to be a dollar received, M times V must equal P times Y. It's just accounting.
Okay, that framework is solid. But, you know, as you said, economists aren't usually just looking at a snapshot. They want to know what happens next.
Exactly. The question is always, if we change one of these things, what happens to the others?
Right. If a central bank cranks up the money supply, how does that ripple through the system?
To do that, to predict the future, we have to shift from looking at levels to looking at, well, at change, at growth rates.
And this is where it gets a little more complex, but also incredibly powerful.
Oh, yes. Because when you're looking at things that are multiplied together, like M and V, and you want to see how their product changes over time.
You add their percentage changes. You don't multiply them.
You add them. It's a property of growth rates. So our full equation in terms of growth becomes the percent change in money supply plus the percent change in velocity.
Equals the percent change in the price level.
Which is just inflation.
Plus the percent change in real output.
Yep. Percent delta M plus percent delta V equals percent delta P plus percent delta Y.
That growth rate equation is, I mean, it's still just an identity, right? It's still true by definition.
It is.
But to turn it into a powerful predictive theory, you have to make one massive simplification. And this is where it gets really interesting and, frankly, pretty controversial.
This is the key. The simplifying assumption, especially in the classical version of this theory, is that velocity, the speed of spending, is constant.
It's fixed.
It's fixed, or at least it doesn't change much. That's the bedrock of the whole theory.
Hang on, why? That seems like a huge leap of faith. I mean, velocity is based on human behavior, right? Spending habits, saving?
It is. And modern economists definitely roll their eyes at this assumption. We can get to that.
Okay.
But the classical argument is that velocity is rooted in stable institutional things. You know, how often people go paid. the structure of the banking system, how quickly payments clear.
So things that don't change very much year to year.
Right. The way you manage your paycheck this year is probably pretty similar to last year. So in a stable, non-crisis economy, the argument goes, these habits are stable. So velocity is stable.
Okay. So if we accept that, if the speed of spending is constant, then its percentage change is zero.
Exactly. It just drops out of the equation.
And that changes everything.
It's the step that transforms the accounting identity into a simple predictive theory. The equation becomes the growth rate of the money supply equals the growth rate of prices plus the growth rate of real output.
So any new money created has to be absorbed by one of only two things.
That's it. Either it finances an increase in the actual stuff being made, growth in output, or just pushes up the prices of everything that already exists.
Which is inflation.
Which is inflation.
Yeah.
There's no third option if spending habits don't change.
That makes the connection just brutally simple. You print money, it has to go somewhere. It either buys new things or makes the old things more expensive.
There's no escape, according to the theory.
Okay, let's make this real. Let's apply this simplified theory to an actual numerical scenario so you, listening, can see how to calculate this yourself.
Okay, so we're working with our core assumption. The speed of spending is stable. We just need two inputs from the economy.
All right, input number one is from the monetary side. We're told that the money supply grew by 5%.
Okay, 5%.
And input number two is from the real economy side, the productivity. We know that real output, the actual amount of stuff produced, grew by a healthy 2%.
So we set up our simple equation. We know the money growth, which is 5%.
Right.
And that has to equal the price growth, which is what we're solving for, plus the output growth, which we know is 2%.
So the question is, if we have 5% more money floating around, but only 2% more real stuff to spend it on, where does the rest of that money, that pressure, go?
To find the inflation rate, we just need to rearrange the formula. We subtract the output growth from the money supply growth.
So we take the 5% money growth and we subtract the 2% growth in real goods.
And the resulting change in the price level is 3%.
So based on those inputs and the big assumption about constant spending habits, the quantity theory of money predicts that inflation will be 3%. It's a beautifully simple prediction.
It is.
Okay, so let's synthesize this. We have the 3% result.
Yeah.
What does this really mean intuitively for the average person? Where did that extra 3% of money growth go?
Right. It represents the part of the money growth that wasn't, let's say, needed to finance real economic expansion. So let's break down that initial 5% increase again.
Okay.
2% of that new money was needed just to handle the 2% increase in goods and services being traded.
Right. Even if prices had stayed exactly the same, you'd still need more money just to buy the new stuff.
Exactly. So you can think of that 2% of money growth as productive. It's non-inflationary.
But the system didn't introduce 2% more money. It introduced 5%.
Right. Which means there's a leftover 3% of money growth, a surplus of cash that entered the system without a corresponding increase in real stuff to buy.
And that excess is what people call too much money chasing too few goods.
That's the very definition of inflation in this model. People have this extra 3% of cash. They try to spend it, but there isn't 3% more stuff. So they just bid up the prices of what's already there.
And that's the logic behind that famous phrase, inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon.
Yes. It puts the responsibility for inflation squarely on the entity controlling the money supply, assuming everything else holds steady.
So you now have the definitive, simple framework for understanding that classic viewpoint.
But, and this is a big but, Our entire 3% calculation hinges on that one critical assumption.
That velocity is constant.
That the speed of spending doesn't change. Because if it does, the whole simple relationship can break down.
This is where the classical theory meets the messy reality of the modern economy.
Yes, exactly. I mean, think about the 2008 financial crisis. Central banks dramatically increased the money supply.
Right, with quantitative easing, massive increases.
So if this simple QTM theory were perfectly true, what should have happened?
We should have seen massive, immediate inflation, hyperinflation even.
But we didn't. Not right away. Why?
Velocity.
Velocity. The money supply skyrocketed, but people and banks got scared. They hoarded the money. Banks held reserves instead of lending. Consumers paid down debt.
The money wasn't moving. The hot potato got cold.
Exactly. The velocity of money plummeted. So in our growth equation, the huge positive number for money growth was canceled out by a huge negative number for velocity growth.
And the equation balanced out without creating much inflation.
It's a perfect example of the assumption failing in the real world.
So let's apply that back to our example. Let's say money supply still grows by 5% and output still grows by 2%.
Yeah.
But instead of velocity being stable, let's say people get nervous and start saving more aggressively. Velocity suddenly drops by 2%.
Okay, so we have to put a minus 2% for velocity back into the equation.
Right, so it becomes 5% for money minus 2% from the drop in velocity.
That means the left side of the equation, the total spending pressure, is now only 3%.
And if that total spending pressure is 3% and 2% of that gets absorbed by the new output,
the resulting inflation is only 1%.
Wow.
The change in human behavior, that drop in velocity, just cut our predicted inflation rate by 2/3, from 3% down to 1.
So a single shift in confidence completely changes the outcome. You can see how sensitive the whole thing is to that one variable.
Which is why modern central banking is so obsessed with psychology and expectations, not just printing money.
So this raises a really important final thought for you to explore on your own.
What if the opposite happens? In times of high inflation, like we've seen recently, people sometimes get scared their money will be worthless tomorrow.
So they try to spend it faster.
They treat it like a hot potato again. What if that psychology takes hold and the velocity of money suddenly increases by 2% on top of our original numbers?
So challenge yourself to run that calculation. 5% money growth, 2% real growth, and now a sudden 2% increase in the speed of spending. See for yourself how that changes the inflation prediction, and you'll understand why velocity is the wild card in this classic economic theory. Thanks for taking the deep dive with us.